दिस इज द पेपर रिगार्डिंग द एडवर्स कॉन्सिक्वेंसेस ऑफ रिफ्यूजल ऑफ ट्रीटमेंट एंड इट्स डॉक्यूमेंटेशन नॉलेज एटीट्यूड एंड प्रैक्टिसेस ऑफ द ऑप्थेल्मोलॉजिस्ट ऑफ द स्टडी इज सेल्फ फंडेड एंड देर इज नो कन्फ्लिक्ट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट एंड नो फिनेंशियल इंटरेस्ट ऑल्सो एज ऑल ऑफ अस आर अवेयर दैट इन्फॉर्म कंसेंट इज एन इंटीग्रल पार्ट ऑफ क्लिनिकल केयर and is an essential fundamental in the modern clinical practices. It has got ethical, legal and practical implications. Obtaining informed consent or the consent is an ethical obligation as well as the legal compulsion nowadays. The accepted national and international medical ethical principles are autonomy, non-maleficence, beneficence and justice. So information, sorry, just a minute please. The principle of autonomy has been expressed in the law by Justice Cordazzo in 1914 and that states that the right to treatment is the fundamental and reflects our respect for the autonomy of the individual. So the consent demonstrates and protects the importance of the right of bodily integrity and its determination. The law of informed consent defines the right to informed refusal. The documentation of refusal involves very crucial points to establish the decision of the refusal falls under the preview of law. Materials and methods. It was a prospective cross-sectional qualitative study using in-depth interview by a mixed method approach. Study methodology workflow was audio-video consent, adhering to the voluntariness, refusal of consent, principles of confidentiality and anonymity, as well as the archival of the audio-video recording and the publication and the presentation of its results in the conferences was meeting. After getting the informed consent form signed from every ophthalmologist, then the discussion happened and the informed consent was signed. In this way, the 232 ophthalmologists across 9 faculties from different cities of Maharashtra in the age group of 25 to 64 years with the experience of 1 to 40 years and 171 male and 142 female. This was the overlap because of the super speciality as I explained last presentation only. Were interviewed using in-depth interview, face-to-face discussion and out of the 148 variables, adverse consequences of refusing the treatment and documentation of the refusal of treatment with the reason was one of the variable. And I thought this is very important. 152 informed consent documents were evaluated. For information and notation about the adverse consequences of refusing the treatment explained to the patients. 74.07% to 100% cornea, VR surgeons, oculoplasty consultants explain the adverse consequences of refusal of treatment or surgery, but that was case specific, not to all the patients. 10.24% to 25.92% of cataract, comprehensive, glaucoma, pediatric ophthalmologists, squint surgeons do not inform the adverse consequences of the refusal of treatment. And the refusal of treatment in the regression analysis showed that statistically significant p-value as 0.03. Evaluation of contents of informed consent forms for information and notation that adverse complications of refusal of surgery was explained was absent in more than 65% of all faculties except the oculoplasty. 73.91% to 100% of consultants do not document the refusal of surgery. Legally competent patients have legal and moral rights to refuse any or all the treatments. Legally, patient can choose the wrong decision leading to serious debility or even the death, as happened in this Jehovah's community where they refuse the life-saving blood transfusion also. Option of a recommended treatment and patient's choice of not accepting it need to be documented. Refusing a treatment or procedure not necessarily mean to refuse all the care. Not providing information about adverse consequences of refusal of surgery or treatment itself is the violation of all legal and ethical principles. Most of ophthalmologists confirm adverse consequences of refusal of treatment were not explained to patient. They do not document the refusal of treatment with reasons. Documentation is very crucial, especially in potential litigation. Interaction needs to be documented if refusal of treatment result in significant damage to prevent the later potential litigations. Documented informed refusal is crucial because of increased patient autonomy and should include patient's competency, notation of voluntariness, lack of coercion, detailed narration of discussion, urgency of treatment and potential adverse consequences, and it should corroborate with the medical records.
Here the name is featuring like Dr. Karishma Goyal.
Thank you.
Good morning, judges. This is Partha here. We need to finish in time, so would request all the judges to wind up as soon as possible. Thank
yes,
you,
sir. This you. Was the last speaker, and it's a non-ratified member. So I think all the judges would be ready with scores, and we'll immediately send to you.
So non-ratified members. Non-ratified member. The scoring is not required. However, if you want to put the scores, you can put the scores. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Shalaka. It was an excellent presentation.
Thank you. There were
a few technical glitches, but it's okay in this era of COVID. Still, your enthusiasm is appreciated. Thank you.
Shalaka, can I have a question?
Yeah, sure, sir.
Dr. Shalaka, you have pre-assumed that confidentiality should be the part of informed consent.
Video.
Then you have interviewed few people. Can I know the reference from where you have taken that confidentiality should be part of informed consent?
अभी हमने वीडियो के साथ ज्वाइन नहीं किया ना?
With reference you have taken?
Sir, actually I am working as a clinical trials consultant. So the consent taken in the clinical trials. Clinical trials or the which is regulated by the DCGI as well as the ethics committee, obviously approved by. So I was finding a lot of difference between the consent taken in the clinical trials and the consent taken in for surgery in my practices. So I decided to go for, and the references for informed consent in clinical practices and in ophthalmology, there is no reference at all available.
In case Samira Kohli versus Prabha Manchanda, yes. Supreme Court has clearly given broad guidelines, but all things should be part of informed consent, and confidentiality was not part of it. And
no, sir,
confidentiality is a part of general consent. It is a part of general consent. It is agreed. But should it be part of procedural informed consent?
Yes, probably, sir, because there are medical legal cases where the confidentiality was maintained, especially the confidentiality. And in the already present days, EMR we are using. So especially if the data gets hacked or misused, how you are going to protect the data also? So confidentiality and privacy relates to the personal confidentiality. As well as the privacy.
Point taken, Dr. Shalaka. But as far as informed consent, it is a legal document and it has defined guidelines based upon that particular case I have mentioned, Samira Kohli versus Prabha Manchanda. But yes, there are other concerns. Okay, general. It is part of general consent, and it is a part of patient's rights as per the patient rights chapter.
Yes, sir.
It was issued by the government of India. Patient rights chapter. It is a part of patient's right. But yes, it is as per the guidelines of Supreme Court judgment. Confidentiality was not part of it. Thank you very much for your input. Thank you, Dr. Shalaka.
Thank you.